Hello, my name is Paul Wallace. I'm the Africa editor of the Banker magazine, and I'm with Patrick Chinamasa, who's the finance minister of Zimbabwe. Minister Chinamasa, thank you very much for joining us. I'd like to start off by asking you about the state of the Zimbabwe economy. It's growing a lot more slowly than most other countries in Southern Africa, and you've admitted yourself to Parliament recently that it's in a bad state. In your opinion, why is that? Why is the economy is the Zimbabwean economy performing as it is?
Yes, as you are aware, our economy has been, over the past 15 years, been heavily battered by imposition of sanctions by the Western countries. As you know, our economy was largely tied to the Western countries, and the imposition of sanctions has left the economy in very bad shape. But we are now coming out of the woods. The challenges remain, they are still there, but we see the light at the end of the tunnel. And we are basically now focusing under our Zim asset, that is Zimbabwe agenda for socio-economic transformation, economic blueprint for the next 5 years. We have focused on putting right the infrastructure. We have a gap in the energy sector, which we need to close. We have our roads are run down, so we need to rehabilitate and expand. Our water systems are also run down. We need to address those as well, the railways, ICT. So we have basically focused in our economic blueprint on putting right the infrastructure so as to create the necessary infrastructural foundation for the economic growth and recovery of our economy. We are also looking at the productive sector, and our priorities are basically agriculture, manufacturing, mining, and tourism. But the challenge we continue to have is that the productive sector are thirsting for capital. There is great need for lines of credit to support the productive sector, support agriculture, that is lending to our farmers, support to the manufacturing, primarily medium to long-term financing to address the issue of retooling, because most of our manufacturing equipment is now obsolete, and we need basically to take advantage or to be abreast of the technological advances that have been made in other countries. We are also looking at support to the to tourism as well as to mining. So those are basically the challenges we are facing, but we see the light at the end of the tunnel, and we are in the process of seeking to mobilize our own resources, because of the sanctions which are still existing, we are basically on our own.
When I speak to investors in Africa, they say that Zimbabwe is a very difficult place, with the indigenisation law still being talked about, and it seems to change the whole time from the government. One day they say that 51% of shares have to be ceded to the government or another Zimbabwean entity. Another day they come forward and say, we'll put forward a bill that says that no foreign investor can own more than 25% of a bank. Is this not going to kill off, is indigenization not going to kill off your attempts to attract foreign direct investment?
Well, I think, thank you for your question. It affords me an opportunity to clarify our policy. Because I think what the challenge we have is to being misunderstood, misinterpreted, misquoted on this very vital policy. And for an explanation and for clarification, I must begin by giving you the historical background. As you know, throughout colonialism and even up to now, Zimbabweans, black Zimbabweans, had no stake in the economy. So basically, the bottom line of our policy on indigenization is to scale up local participation in our economy, in all sectors of our economy. But we are not saying that scaling up will be done in a confrontational manner, or that will impose or will discount any investments that come to Zimbabwe. Let's distinguish the mining sector. The mining sector, which is, we have resources, the diamonds. These resources belong to Zimbabweans. And basically what we are saying with respect to the mining sector, we are saying any investor who comes must recognize that the asset belongs to us, that through exploitation it will be depleting. And therefore we want a cut off that depleting resource as it is being exploited. So the 51-49% you are talking about is in the mining sector. There is nothing cast in stone. In other sectors, we have never said that if you bring your money to buy equipment, to set up a manufacturing equipment, you will have 51% of your money. Or in the financial services sector, if you bring your money to buy into, to set up a bank, we have never said we want 51% of that. What we have said to all would-be investors is that take account of the historical background. Look, as you set up shop in Zimbabwe, have in mind to include local investors as well. And they are of your choosing, and they must pay for what you sell to them. There is nothing that is going to go for free. You have to choose your partners, you have to choose, you decide your price, and so forth. But we are basically saying, be cognizant that your investments are safer if there is greater local participation in the economy. That basically is the gist of our message.
Let's talk quickly about this 25% rule that's come out recently in Zimbabwe, where a bill might be passed stating that, as far as I'm aware, that foreign investors can't own more than 25% of any bank. Is that something?
Who found that? Because I'm not aware of that. Because what I know I've been doing is basically to say we are going to do a sector-by-sector approach. And I don't think that can happen when I'm away.
One of Zimbabwe's priorities at the moment is to get debt relief. It has a large debt to GDP ratio of over 100%. It can't get more foreign loans until it addresses that problem. The IMF recently reopened an office in Harare. How close are you to concluding negotiations with external creditors?
Well, I can say that we have a very constructive engagement with the IMF. And the evidence of that, of course, is that the IMF is going to open an office probably this month or next month in Zimbabwe, which demonstrates the close, constructive working relationship that we have between my country and the IMF. We are, as you are aware, under a staff-monitored program. We are pursuing policies under the staff-monitored program, not because of the IMF, but because we think that these policies are necessary. They are formulated and crafted by us and are necessary to achieve macroeconomic stability in our economy. They are in our interests. And the IMF is basically assisting us in terms of advice, in terms of support, to make sure that we implement. Where we have challenges in implementing them, again, we've had very constructive discussions over that, because there are some challenges. For instance, the ratio of wages to the budget is too high, 85%. And we have indicated to the IMF that we can't correct it overnight. It has to be a long process, largely attacked or resolved through broadening the revenue base, expanding the size of our budget, the size of our cake, so that employment costs can take their proper proportion within a larger cake. So the discussions we have are very constructive, and we have indicated to them that we are committed to implementing the staff monitored program, not because of them, but because these are good for Zimbabwe.
What about indigenisation, though? Is the IMF not going to look at indigenisation and say, look, we're not going to give you debt relief and stuff unless you, cut that?
To my knowledge, especially in the light of the discussions that I've held with them since I was appointed last September, the IMF never dictates to anyone. It may only point out whether there are certain policies which are inhibiting to foreign direct investment. It's for us as Zimbabweans to look at those policies and have a sense of introspection to see whether or not that is correct or not.
And just lastly, Mr. Chinamasa, in your view, do you think Zimbabwe gets treated unfairly by foreign investors because of Western perceptions about its politics and perceptions about Robert Mugabe?
You've hit it on the head. You've hit it on the head. Because when we compare our situation, our circumstances, to other countries which receive very favorable treatment than us, it becomes very clear that the element of discrimination is there. The perception is very strong, sometimes understandably, because the perception seems to revolve around our attitude towards property rights, given the background or the historical reason of the resolution of the land question. But certainly the British and other, they should know this is a colonial question. A colonial question over which we had to fight an 18-year armed struggle to correct. A colonial question which in 1979 at Lancaster, we were promised by the British and American governments that resources would be made available to pay compensation to the white farmers. And it's a colonial question where those who made those promises reneged on those promises. And we had to resolve it in the manner that we did. So that is always lost, that background. It's completely lost.
But that was back in 1979. Zimbabwe's been, if you like, it's had full independence since 1980, is it?
Yes, but promises made by big powers must be respected. Mrs. Thatcher, President Carter made commitments in 1979. They even asked us to postpone the resolution of land redistribution for 10 years. And they asked us to put it in the constitution. We didn't touch the land question for the first 10 years, primarily because of the understanding that we had in 1979. After the 10 years, we amended the constitution and we continued to get the support of Mrs. Thatcher, John Major. After he lost the elections and when Tony Blair came in, he reneged on his colonial responsibility, especially the undertaking that were made in 1979. So you can't say we are independent for this long. Promises were made. They knew in 79, like they would know even subsequently, that we had no capacity to pay for dispossession of our land during the colonial era. They knew that. They knew what the war was about. That it was about equity, redressing the land question primarily. So any reneging on that, surely, certainly the British should have a bad conscience on that.
Minister Chinamasa, thank you very much for your time.